Grace and peace to you from God our Father, from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Have you ever noticed how much I drink water up here? I do it a lot, don't I? It's because I want my mouth to be wet, and I want to be able to sing, and I want to be able to recite things with you. And you know, this morning I was thinking, you sing a lot, and you say a lot of things too, so I thought I would offer you a glass of water. There it is. A glass of water for you. I also have another glass that has water in it. And here it is. Which glass of water would you like? You're probably thinking to yourself, oh, Pastor, I want the one that's not foaming at the top. And that'd be a good choice, right? Because in this glass is water, but I've also put some toilet paper in it. That's kind of dangerous if you drink it. Listen to what the label says. It says, if swallowed, call a poison control or doctor immediately for treatment advice. Have a person sip a glass of water if able to swallow. Do not induce vomiting unless told by a poison control center or a doctor. Do not give anything by mouth to a doctor. Kind of dangerous stuff if you drink it in. And which of you, if you ask someone for a glass of water and they offered you this, would want to trust them? You probably wouldn't, would you? What's kind of interesting is Jesus says something very similar in our lesson today. As we listen to Jesus' words, he says, watch out for people who try to offer you something other than the truth of my gospel. He says, watch out for false prophets. And the reason he says this is because those false prophets are dangerous and they're destructive. As we look at our lesson this morning from Matthew, we realize that we're at the very end of the Sermon on the Mount. That long sermon that starts at the beginning of Matthew chapter 5 and goes to the end of Matthew chapter 7. And we're really catching the tail end of it right here before us this morning. And as we listen to Jesus' word, we realize that he's kind of wrapping up this Sermon on the Mount. And what he tells us is befitting for everyone who wants to be a Christian, and that is, watch out for false prophets. If you've known how clever I am, I use Jesus' words to be the theme of my sermon, and they come from the very first verse of our section. This is what Jesus says. He says, watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. And this verse really sets the stage for the rest of the verses that come to follow, because it really, the rest of the verses explain what Jesus tells us in this verse. And Jesus says, false prophets, they come to you in sheep's clothing. And that means something for us. It means that when we come across somebody who is a false prophet, at first glance, we might not recognize them as a false prophet. They come to us in sheep's clothing, meaning they might be very nice. They might be very sincere. They might come to us and say that this is the truth and believe that with all their heart. But the truth of the matter is that some people who preach God's word are not just in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are, as our Lord says, ravenous wolves. Which means that false prophets are dangerous. They're not as they portray themselves as sheep, but rather there's someone who comes and they don't just give you pure water to drink, but they add or they take away from God's word and they manipulate it so that it's different. And that's dangerous. Very dangerous and very destructive. And so our job as Christians is to be careful, isn't it? It is to see anybody who comes to us teaching God's word, and for us to essentially test them out. Jesus tells us how we are to identify false prophets in the verses to come. He says this, he says, by their fruit you will recognize them. You do not gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles, do you? So then, every good tree produces good fruit, but a bad tree produces bad fruit. A good tree cannot produce bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot produce good fruit. Every tree that does not produce good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. So then, by their fruits, you will recognize them. And maybe you're thinking to yourself, what's Jesus talking about with all this fruit business? a teacher of God's word, and they start teaching to you, and you recognize that what they're teaching to you is not what you know God's word to be, you found yourself a thorn bush. You found yourself a thistle. It's someone who has bad fruit. They're producing bad teachings, teachings that our Lord has not given us. And so we want to separate ourselves from them. And if you listen to someone preaching the truth of God's word to you, and you hear them and they're teaching everything that you know God's word to be, well, you found yourself a fruit tree that produces good fruit. And you want to cling to those people because they give you the true word of God. As Christians, when we hear Jesus say this, it really is some instructions for us. And no matter who it is, if they proclaim to speak God's word to you, you must take what they say and place it against Scripture. And make sure that what they are teaching is God's word. And that means being prudent. I stand up here every week and I proclaim to you what God's word says. You better hold that against Scripture to make sure that I am not giving you bad fruit. And I can guarantee you that's my intention, is that I feed you with pure God's word. Not anything that's added or taken away, not this, because I want nothing to do with harming your faith, but rather I want your faith to grow and to be strengthened. Think of it like this. False prophets. It's like somebody that's out on the street selling food. Not selling food, giving it away. So you go down the street and you find someone, they've got a table, and they've got a bunch of Kugan sitting there, and they're just giving it away. You start talking to this individual, you say, "This looks really great. I think this smells pretty good. Do you mind if I have a slice?" I said, "Sure. I'm giving it away to everybody." So he gives you a slice of his Kugan. Smells good, looks good, the texture seems to be just like what you know. Take a piece of it, you put it in your mouth, you start to chew, you taste it, and think to yourself, "Something's off." And you, being wise as you are, you've made Kugan before, so you know the recipe for Kugan, so you ask this individual, you say, "What's in this?" And so he starts rattling off all these different ingredients, cream, sugar, vanilla side, a little bit of cherry for flavor, and you say, whoa, what did you just say about this? And you yourself, "I don't think that's supposed to be a Kugan." And so you get out your phone, you Google it, and what do you come up with? You realize that vanilla side is rat poison. What are you going to do with that piece of Kugan that you're eating? You're going to spit it out, aren't you? You're going to get rid of it, and you're going to hand it back to him and say, "I want nothing to do with what you're offering." And if you see him again later on, and he comes up to you and says, "Listen, I've made some cookies. Would you like some?" What are you going to say? "No, thank you." Why? Because you know that what he has is not meant for your good, but it's there, and it can harm you. So you walk away from it. And that's what we are to do with false prophets, because false prophets are dangerous. And they're very good at what they do. They speak falsehood. And it sometimes can be so dangerous that it can cause some people who think that they are safe in God's word to be misled. I mean, it's kind of amazing to see what Jesus speaks about in our lesson. He goes on to say this. He says, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven." That's a scary thought. To think that false prophets are good enough to get people to think that they're safe under God's protection, but when the day of judgment comes, they approach Jesus and say, "Lord, Lord," and what is Jesus' response to them? "I never knew you. Get away from me." It's a scary thought. False prophets are dangerous. And the reason they're dangerous is because they take God's word and they change. And they manipulate it. And they take your hope and they take your comfort and they place it in other things that are not our Savior, Jesus Christ. And if you do that, if you place your trust somewhere else, you'll end up just like the false prophets. And our Lord says, those prophets are to be cut down and thrown into the fire. Scary thought. But you can see exactly what Jesus is saying when he talks about the interaction that happens between one of these individuals who is misled by a false prophet. This is what Jesus said. He says, "Many will say to me on that day," the day of judgment, "Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and drive out demons in your name and perform many miracles in your name?"
Without knowledge, I never knew you. Apart from me, evil doers.
Did you notice anything wrong with what those individuals were coming to Jesus and saying? One thing is for sure is that they did do some great things. They drove demons. They had miracles. But where was their hope? Where was their confidence? I'll read it one more time. They said, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And drive out demons in your name and perform any miracles in your name? Where are they placing their trust? Not in Jesus, but rather in themselves, aren't they? Lord, we did all this stuff. Isn't that evidence enough? We did this stuff. Shouldn't we be in heaven? And Jesus' response to those who place their confidence and trust in their works is what? On the day of judgment, he says, I never knew you. Depart from me, you evildoers. And for us, as Lutherans, we think to ourselves, that is just right against the heart and core of God's word. And we heard from Romans today that you can't justify yourself by the law, by the things that you do, but rather it's only through God's grace, through faith in Jesus Christ. And yet the sad truth is sometimes we buy into those false prophets. Sometimes we buy into the idea that it's all about what we do. Sometimes we think to ourselves, well, as long as I show up in church, me and God are square. For as long as I belong to a church in name, I'm good. You know, I'm a part of a church, that means God's going to let me in. And the truth of the matter is that it's not what it means. Faith is not defined by the actions that we do for God. Faith is defined in the trust that you have in our Savior Jesus Christ. So if you think you can come before God and say, look at all I've done, God, for you, that you'll get into heaven, you're wrong. If you do that, what you're doing is really building on the sand of the foundation. And that's what Jesus says at the very end of the lesson. He talks about two types of people. One person who builds their foundation on bedrock, the other type who builds it on sand. These are Jesus' words. He says, everyone who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on bedrock. The rain came down, the rivers rose, the winds blew and beat against that house, but it did not fall because it was found on bedrock. And everyone who hears these words of mine but does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the river rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell. It was completely destroyed. If we look anywhere else besides the saving action of our Savior Jesus Christ, we are building on a sandy foundation. And what that means is on the day of judgment, our house that we build on our own words will come down with a great big crash. We will be completely destroyed. It's only those who set aside their works and look only to their Savior Jesus for their salvation. It's only those who build on the bedrock of God's word, which is salvation by grace through faith in our Savior Jesus Christ. Only those who trust in Jesus for their forgiveness. Only those who look to the blood of Jesus spilled on Calvary for their sins are the ones who will enter into the kingdom of heaven. That is the true gospel. And that means that those who look to Jesus for their salvation will have. That means you and I are forgiven because of what Jesus has done for us. All those times that we give an ear to those false prophets who say, you know, if you just do these seven steps, your life will be great today. We're forgiven. For all those times that we think in our mind, well, you know, as long as I'm here going through the motions, that's all I've got to do. We're forgiven. You see, through the blood of Jesus Christ, we are filled with the bedrock of God's word. And because we have been built on Jesus Christ and placed all of our trust in him, we have an eternity in heaven out of God's grace. That is the pure gospel with nothing added, nothing taken away. And that is what makes us wise unto salvation. So we listen to Jesus' words. He says, be careful. Watch out for false prophets who come to you and claim to offer you water, but they add something dangerous to it. He says, watch out for false prophets.
They are dangerous and destructive. Rather, look only to my word. Look only to my Savior, Jesus Christ, the one I provided for you, for all of your salvation, for all of your life. Brothers and sisters, let us cling to God's word and look to keep it in its truth and its purity so that we may pass it on to our children and the children's children, that they too may be built on the bedrock of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.